So you're in law enforcement again.
Law enforcement again. They like to see me playing cops, man. good cops, bad cops, weird cops, just weird sheriffs, all of the above, yeah.
So he has a suspicion about the doctor.
He does. I think he has a deep-rooted suspicion regarding everyone, but I think Harry definitely sets off his red flag. He's just such an odd guy. One of the hard parts about filming was keeping a straight face with Alan, because some of the little tics and mannerisms that he was using there were really, really, really funny. And I think the sheriff definitely has him in his crosshair. But I mean, I don't think anyone. The beauty of it is, I mean, you can think someone as weird as you want, but no one would think in their head that he's an alien. So, you know, his behavior is odd and unique, and maybe they think he's on the spectrum in some way or something like that, but no one in their right mind would think that he's actually an alien. So it's interesting. What I think is a cool part about this is that the audience knows more than the characters. You know what I mean? Like, usually the characters know stuff, and then you parse it out to the audience, and, you know, you got to watch 45 minutes of a show to get 2 minutes of new information. Well, the difference with, you know, with our setup is the audience knows everything from the pilot. They know why he's here. They know he's an alien. They know he's strong. They know he's got a propensity for murder. But we still root for him, which is kind of fun as well. You know, I mean, it's not too often. You know you're doing something right in the writing and in your performance if you can get people to root for someone trying to kill a kid.
You said, you know, you played the bad cop, the good cop, the whatever. What do you think he is? I mean, do you define him as good, bad, weird, what?
I think he's got good intentions.
Okay.
And I think that he believes that the outcome is what matters. So if he's got to do something that feels a little wonky to get to the place that he sure exists, then I think that's probably his mentality. I think he's a good cop. I don't think that he's, I don't think he's a part of the criminal underbelly. But he's certainly no savior by any means. He's got some deficiencies as well. Like I said, I think it's great because all the characters are just the right amount of weird.
You know? Can you tell us a little how you got involved with the project?
I got the script like everyone else, and I read it, and I loved it from day one. I actually shared a text with Chris that I sent to a buddy of mine after I read the pilot, and I was like, dude, I just read this pilot. It's like one of the best things I've read, and blah, blah, blah. And so when I sent it to Chris after I got cast, because I also had in there, you know, my friend responding, he was like, oh, I hope you get it. And I was like, I won't. You know what I mean? That's exactly what my exact words were. And I put like a whole litany of emojis that show the emotions of the actor going from hope to despair. And but no, I was wrong, and it worked out. I knew there was something very special about this from the very beginning, and I was actually, at the moment when I had this opportunity come up, I had a couple of different opportunities that were on the table. None of them were things that would have worked together, so I had to make a choice, and it was pretty evident to me from the first moment I started turning the pages. And there's stuff that was in the pilot that I read that's coming up later in the season that you guys don't know about, that I can't tell you about. But it's... It's a really unique project with a unique voice, and quite frankly, you know, as you know, you mentioned your wife in the closer, the procedural realm is so kind of static in the sense of when you're playing a detective on a show like the closer, you're not allowed to reference the past in the sense of, hey, do you remember that other case we had that had to do with this and that, so. After a while, I started to feel like I was a better detective than Gabriel, the guy that I was playing. You know what I mean? I was just like, we have to keep pretending that we don't know stuff that we've learned. So this opportunity created a place for me to do a type of character that no one's ever seen me do. And Chris is really great about letting us improvise, which I love to do. And I wanted to do something that was a complete kind of departure from anything anyone's ever seen. I kind of... As I said on the stage, I see this character as kind of a mashup of John Wayne and Richard Pryor. And that's kind of what I, you know, when I told Chris, he was like, that's fucking great. But yeah, I want him to be different. I wanted him to be unlike any other person of color that we've seen on television in any recent years, you know what I mean? So I try to bring in a little bit of everything. Like the beatboxing scene was something that we joked about. It wasn't in the pilot when I booked it. And Chris and David and I talked about it, and we kind of talked through the scene, and they were like, I think we should put this in. And, you know, we did. So to have that type of collaboration when you're there to shoot the pilot. You know what I mean? Like, you're way past the writing phase when you're actually there to shoot the pilot. So to have them be open to our creativity and our input, even at that late phase of things, was really refreshing.
So before you get a chance to see who's going to be involved in it, whether it be the writing or any of the other actors, what are some things when you're getting involved in a project that, you know, sort of you look for to make sure this is the right thing for you and your career?
I think, you know, I've what really kind of like jumped out to me, I think, was just the unique voice of this. I'm always looking to do something different. You know, I think when you have the kind of history that I've had with starting off in theater, and I've experienced some pretty exciting times on Broadway and some pretty exciting times on another hit television show, and I wanted to do something that was that felt unique, that felt interesting, that felt different. And I know that's kind of vague, but there's really no way to really describe what it was, that X factor, that it thing that you can always recognize, but you can't always describe.
Yeah.
I knew there was something very unique about this particular story from day one, and I just wanted to do something that felt like similar to like Straight Out of Compton when I played Lonzo with the Jerry Crow. I just wanted to do. I had been Gabriel for so long, and I wanted to show people that that was just a character in the repertoire that I have versus this is what I do. You know what I mean? So
it's like, oh, he's another cop.
You know? Right, right, exactly. And I mean, and since Gabriel, you know, I played district attorneys and lawyers and all doctors and all that stuff. But I wanted to do something that felt like it's okay for this guy to be unlikable. I've never had a character that I was able to make unlikable in ways. And that's fun. When you're playing the bad guy, not he's a bad guy, but you have no rules. Mm-hmm. You can do whatever you want. You know, it's the characters that are in you know, that are filled with integrity and are the good guys that you have to play within the parameters of what's right and wrong. And to remove that component for me was so freeing as an actor. So I'll do this shit as long as they want me here.
Do you like the improv?
Oh, I love it. It's my favorite. I mean, and to the point where, you know, we're Christian and David, they were like, well, give us something different every time. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. If you want to, and then they just take what they want. You know, another thing that we did in the pilot that I'm not sure if we're going to do for the series, but we never rehearsed. We never rehearsed any of those scenes before we filmed it. Other than the table read where we read them at the table, David would come in and Chris and he'd be like, okay, we got the camera set. I kind of see you guys over here. Let's get weird. And, and we would just film it. And, you know, they weren't all winners. You know what I mean? And there were some moments where we probably could have used some rehearsal. But I kind of liked that pseudo chaos. I feel like it created some moments that wouldn't have existed in a more stabilized, you know, filming fashion.
Was there any blooper moments that stood out?
A lot of F-bombs. A lot of F-bombs. I dropped a lot of F-bombs. And I kept waiting for someone to come over to me and say, hey, we love your energy, but we can't use any of this shit. We can't. We've got to find. No, it was actually the opposite. I would say the most out, and you know, there's hopefully we'll do it. You'll see an outtakes at some point, but you know, some of this stuff in the pilot, I would say the most ridiculous shit. And I, you know, they yell cut, and then Dave and Chris come over, and I was expecting, I was like, oh shit, here it comes. This is the talking to that I was been expecting all the time. And they're like, dude, that's great. Next time, do something else. And I was like, okay, you know, just keep going. Why not? I mean, you know, and then you use what you want to use, and you don't what you don't. But it felt, as an actor, it felt good to have that type of freedom. Yeah.
I'm curious if with your character from The Closer, or even this character, if there's some little nuances that are uniquely you that you bring to the characters that like maybe people won't notice, but you know for sure.
I think I do a lot of my acting with my face. You know what I mean? I think that Gabriel was very similar in that, you know, there's a lot that can be said with a look or with an expression. And that's probably the biggest through line through my performances. Oftentimes, though, you're not always in a position where people want you to. So, yeah, we love what you're doing, but fix your face. You know what I mean? Something's going on with your face. Just stand there, you know, whatever. Those are probably, I examine my work and I can see parallels in various ways, but I really try to make them different. I mean, I think in some weird, twisted world, Gabriel and Sheriff Mike might have been friends in some way. I think Gabriel probably would find him amusing, and I think Sheriff Mike would probably find Gabriel suspicious. That's just how he is.
Oh no, he just keeps acting with
this
face,
guy. Yeah. There's something wrong with your face. I don't trust your face.
So are they out there?
Aliens?
Yeah.
I think you'd be hard pressed to think that aliens aren't real. Only because I'm just looking at it from the mathematics standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're talking about our galaxy alone. You have billions and billions of stars that likely have billions and billions of exoplanets.
Guys, we have 1 minute, and then we're going to switch.
All right, it would be just absolutely ridiculous to not have intelligent life out there. I think the thing that keeps us separated is interstellar and intergalactic travel, and what it takes to be able to traverse that type of distance between the stars, unless you have an alien society that has the technology to stay alive long enough to travel faster than the speed of light, or somehow create a wormhole that allows them to jump from one place to the next. There would be no real way. I mean, I think our closest star, Alpha Centauri, is at 20 some light years away.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
And that's traveling 189,000 miles per second. And you'd have to travel at that speed and have the ability to shield whatever you're traveling in from any type of space debris. I mean, a grain of dust at that point, you know, and moving at that speed, mm-hmm. punch a hole in the hull of a ship. So and if they do come here, that means they have all of those things, and that means we're fucked. We are done, okay? And, you know, sadly, it might take an alien invasion for us to all see each other the same.
Yeah.
But if they're coming here, we're done. It's over. It's over. They have everything they need, unless they're, like, coming from Mars. Even then, we're done. But if they're coming from another star, we are truly, truly doomed.
We have a lot of movies we can watch for reference.
Oh, absolutely. Sure.
I think you're ready for another documentary gig.
Yeah, well, you know, I firmly believe that they are absolutely out there, and they may be avoiding us. Who knows? They might just be watching us. Can you look at these raggedy motherfuckers? I mean, look at these raggedy humans. Look at these
they
motherfuckers.
Breathe with their mouths.
They breathe with their mouths. They don't even eat with their butts.
Thank you.
Thank you.